Good morning. Welcome back. Doesn't it feel like it's been forever? What a blessing it is to come back together as the body of Christ. Thank the Lord for modern technology, but it's always best to come together and fellowship one with another, to stir one another up to love and to good works. Amen? Amen. Amen. Are we on right here? Are we okay? Okay. Hey, let's turn in our Bibles this morning to Philippians chapter 3. If you're visiting with us here, welcome. We go verse by verse on Sunday mornings as we're currently in the book of Philippians. On Wednesday nights, we go chapter by chapter. And we're in the book of Judges currently on Wednesday nights. What a blessing that's been as well. Philippians chapter 3, and we're going to be looking at verses 4 through 10 this morning. Actually, it's 4 through 9. And we're actually going to start just before verse 4 in verse 3 here. Actually, you know, let's just go ahead and read the whole thing from verse 1. You know, let's go back to chapter 1. No, just kidding. Hey, it's been a couple weeks. You guys got to let me get back into it here. So let's, chapter 3, verse 1. Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. For me to write the same things to you is not tedious, but for you it is safe. Beware of dogs. Beware of evil workers. Beware of the mutilation. For we are the circumcision who worship God in the Spirit, rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh. Though I also might have confidence in the flesh, if anyone else thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I more so. Circumcised the eighth day, of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews, concerning the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, concerning the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. But what things were gain to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. Yet indeed I also count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith. Let's pray. Father, as we come to sit at your table once again together as your body, Lord, may you speak to us by your Holy Spirit through your word. Lord, may we hear, may we learn what Paul learned, Lord. May we hear from you and be open to being changed by the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord. Even now, have your way with us, Lord. You are the potter. We are the clay, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As you go throughout the letters of the New Testament, as we even look at the teachings of Jesus, as we look at the book of Acts, we see over and over and over again the warnings about false teachers coming into the church and also false teachers rising up from within the church. And here, Paul is specifically addressing people known as Judaizers, as they would come into the church and they would teach them that you had to obey the things of the law. Go back to the Old Testament. You needed to be circumcised if you were really going to be a Christian. And by the way, they would also teach if you didn't do this, you weren't a Christian at all. But Paul, notice it's interesting. I love how Paul just kind of puts it right out there. We covered this. By the way, it's on video, on live stream, if you want to go check out last week's study that we just did online. But he said, look, he calls them, beware of dogs, verse 2. Beware of evil workers. Beware the mutilation. So that's what he thinks about these guys. He pulls the gloves off. He's like, hey, man, these guys are dogs. They're evil workers, and they're bringing mutilation. Because notice he goes on to say at the end of verse 3, have no confidence in the flesh. You see, as Christians, we are those who've recognized that there's no more to nothing to be confident in our flesh anymore. We're not to look at our good works. We're not to look at our religiosity. Hey, well, I go to church every Sunday. I hear Pastor Bill preach. I read my Bible every day. Hey, these guys and gals read their Bibles. They memorized probably more than what a lot of people have ever read of the Bible. They could show, quote over and over scriptures and different things, but it wasn't that. It was they forgot the main thing, to love the Lord their God with everything that they are. Have no confidence in the flesh. You know, it's interesting. As we talked about this last week, you might remember we looked at Acts chapter 15. And in Acts chapter 15, we're told there was no small dispute between Paul and Barnabas and these false teachers. They even ended up going all the way up to Jerusalem to meet with the elders there and to have this whole thing worked out. Let's turn back to Acts chapter 15, if you will. Just keep your finger there in Philippians. Acts chapter 15, starting in verse 23. Acts chapter 15, starting in verse 23. So this is as they're all coming together. Basically, as they're coming together, they'd had this meeting. They put a letter together to send to the Judaizers, to send to the churches out there, and also, basically to address the Gentiles that were coming into the church. So Acts 15, verse 23. The apostles, the elders, and the brethren, to the brethren who are of the Gentiles in Antioch, Syria, and Cilicia, greetings. Since we have heard that some who went out from us have troubled you with words, unsettling your souls, saying you must be circumcised and keep the law, to whom we gave no such commandment. It seemed good to us, being assembled with one accord, to send chosen men to you with our beloved Paul, Barnabas and Paul. You know, just one quick, brief side note. Notice here at the end of verse 24, it says, they came, they troubled you, but it says, to whom we gave no such commandments. Beware of pastors and teachers who stand up here and give you no such commandments as come from the Word of God. Hey, and there's a lot of us doing it out here today. Hey, and even if I do it, hold us continually, be a Berean. Check what I'm teaching. Check whatever, if you're listening to somebody on the radio, if there's even a song that you love, a Christian song, check it out. Make sure they're not introducing things that have no such commandment has been given. Now, verse 26 continues, men who have risked their lives, talking about Paul and Barnabas, for the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have therefore sent Judas and Silas, who will also report the same things by word of mouth. For it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things, that you abstain from things offered to idols, from blood, from things strangled, and from sexual immorality. If you will keep yourselves from these, you will do well. Farewell. Now, this is before the rest of the New Testament was written, but this is laying a groundwork for them. Note here that keeping the law was basically called a burden. We don't want to place any further burden upon you. You know, if you're still there, you can even look in back at chapter 15 at verse 6. As they're talking about this in Acts, it says, you don't have to turn there, but if you are there, Acts chapter 6 or 15, verse 6, it says this. Now the apostles and elders came together to consider the matter. And when there had been much dispute, Peter rose up and said to them, men, brethren, you know that a good while ago God chose among us that by my mouth the Gentiles should hear the word of the gospel and believe. So God, who knows the heart, acknowledged them by giving them the Holy Spirit just as he did to us, and made no distinction between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Now therefore, check this out in verse 10. Now therefore, why do you test God by putting a yoke on the neck of the disciples which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved in the same manner as they. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
Amen. You know, last week online, we were talking about how there are still people today who are coming into the church. I remember back in 98, we were pastoring up in Estes Park, Colorado, and this lady brought in this Jewish Bible, and this fellow, and they're all getting into the Judaism of Christianity, and just, you know, all this, oh yeah, did you know that the New Testament was originally written in Hebrew? And tell me, it's like, no, it wasn't. It was written in Greek, Koine Greek. As a matter of fact, if you go to the British Museum, they have a copy of, or a portion of the book of Matthew that could actually be the original book of Matthew from the original book. Guess what? It's in Greek. It's in Koine Greek, common Greek, the most common language of the day. But my point is they were coming into the church, and let's get back to our Jewish roots. Well, if you're Jewish, that can be okay. But Christianity isn't about the Jewish roots. It's about going all the way back to the Garden of Eden. Our roots now are in Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. It's not about let's get more Jewish. It's about, hey, the Jewish people, by the way, God is still going to use them. Can I have an amen? Amen. He's not done with them. They are his chosen people. So when I'm saying this, it's not a put down on the Jewish people. It's a warning to us. And just as Paul is warning, don't go back there. Peter said, dude, our forefathers couldn't even keep it. Why are we having them trying to go back there? It's craziness. And so that's what Paul is addressing here. These men were very dangerous as they were coming into the churches and causing all kinds of craziness. Today we can compare it to doing religious works. Well, if you do this, and you do this, and you do that, and you make sure you cross your T's and you dot your I's, then you can go to heaven. Amen? Amen. And it all depends on if you come to this church and you're under my rule, right? Amen? Or a rule of a group of guys or gals or whatever. No. No, beloved in Christ. Our salvation is by grace alone. Amen? Through faith, that is, even that's something we can't brag about, we're told, because that's a gift from God. We're saved by grace, we're kept by grace. Now, we're saved unto good works, amen? Those good works come as we respond to the Lord. But again, we need to understand that it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. So they were trying to come into the church and say, if you don't do this, if you don't do that, you have to do this, you have to do that. Well, Paul addressed something similar in Romans chapter 3, verse 23. He said this, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God sent forth as a propitiation by his blood through faith, to demonstrate his righteousness. Have no confidence in the flesh. Look at back in our text, verse 4. He said, though I also might have confidence in the flesh. Hey, if anyone thinks he may also, or he may have confidence in the flesh, I more so. For you Bible students, you who take notes, underline that in your Bible. Highlight, I more so. Paul is saying, oh, you think these guys that are coming in and messing you up, calling you back to Judaism and to do the law and get circumcised, you think they have a pedigree? Dude, I blow them all out of the water. Look at verse 5. Circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin. He knew what his tribe was, and that wasn't always known in those days. He was a Hebrew of the Hebrews. Concerning the law, he was a Pharisee. Concerning zeal, persecuting the church. Concerning the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. So he lays down his pedigree. Who is this guy? Who does Paul think he is? He doesn't know anything. They would come into the cities after Paul would share the gospel and set these churches up, and they'd start to question Paul and question his word and question the word of God and tear it down. Does it sound familiar today? come in and start questioning, well, hath God really said? Paul gave a list here, a long list of who he was, what he did to be blameless, according to what he and other religious leaders thought the law meant. He said, look, I'm not from the outside in all this. I'm not a Gentile. You know, even though I'm a Roman citizen, I'm a Hebrew of the Hebrews. Notice he says, I was circumcised on the eighth day, just as it was supposed to be. He was born an Israelite, a tribe, the tribe of Benjamin. He said, I'm really a Hebrew among the Hebrews. Man, my stock is pure and clean. I've kept the law. I was even a Pharisee, down to the strictest keeping of the law. And by the way, this is the outward keeping of the law. Jesus dealt with this in Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, and other places. I had so much zeal, he said, that he even persecuted the church. Because you want to talk about pedigrees? Let's line them up. I was blameless according to how we interpreted the law as Jews. So he's telling them, look, you know, don't listen to these people. You might think they come in and, well, they have all these degrees. You know, they have all these, you know, letters before their names and after their names. Hey, I'm not against education, but when it brings us away from the Word of God, especially as it's doing in many of our Bible colleges and schools of theology, when we spend more time studying what men and women have said about God's Word than we spent studying the Word. I remember years ago talking to a fellow, and we were having a slight disagreement, and we were kind of equal in our positions in a church, and I came into his office, and he had, I'm not kidding, probably bookshelves that went from here to probably where that fire thing was, just all full of books, but they were all, like, you could tell from two full volume sets would be of from one theology thing and then another theology set, and all these books on theology. And he'd graduated with his MDiv and was very proud of it, and you know, he called himself, you know, that he was a theologian in different things. And then as we're discussing, I kept bringing up the scripture over and over, just bringing up the scripture. This is what the Bible says. And he looks at me and goes, man, you sure do know your Bible. And I looked at him and I said, you know what? And I wasn't being mean. And he could tell. I said, it's really sad that you don't. Here's a guy who, you know, I graduated from seminary. I studied Greek. I studied Hebrew. I did all those fun things. And yes, as we were doing so, I remember in the school of ministry, our heads were getting bigger and bigger, for we thought we were so much better than everyone else. You see, and that's what Paul is doing. He's taking a little pin out, if you will, and popping the heads of these big-headed people. You're not as special as you think. They're not as great as you. I studied all these things. He sat at the feet of Gamaliel, who was one of the great tutors within in Jerusalem, in the whole nation of Israel. Paul was there, man. He was, look, man, for anybody who doubts his qualifications, he's just laying it out. Now, how does that apply to us? You know, it actually applies, I think, quite well to us. Well, you know, it's not about who we are. Amen? It's not about who we are. And what I mean by this is, well, I was saved back in the tent days. You know, I was there when Chuck was setting it up, or I was saved in 1942, and this and that, or I was saved 2 years ago, dude, and I'm all that in a bag of chicks. I'm 20-something, you know, and I'm the coolest dude on the block. It's not about you, Homer. It's not about me. It's about Jesus Christ. It's not about, well, you know, my mom and dad were, you know, my dad was a pastor and thus I'm a Christian. Or my mom and dad brought me to church every Sunday and we even made me go to the teen fellowship and we'd go on Friday and Wednesday nights. It doesn't make you a Christian. Just like walking into McDonald's doesn't make you a Big Mac. Well, I was born into the church. My mom and dad were Christians, so I'm a Christian. No, that's not true. You're raised up in a blessing of that, the Bible teaches. There's a blessing, but there comes a point. It doesn't matter. Well, I'm a Methodist.
Well, I'm a Baptist. Well, I'm a Southern Baptist. I'm a Northern Baptist. I'm an American Baptist. I'm an American this.
Forget it.
It doesn't matter. Well, I keep all the rules. I read the Bible, I just keep all the rules, and I'm just like, I don't do that, and I do this, and this, I'm just perfect.
No, you're not. No, I'm not. Now that's to be our aim, by the way. We read the Word of God, and Lord, this doesn't please you. You don't want us to do this. You want us to do these things. And it's interesting. The Bible says these things now, the commands of the Lord are not burdensome to those who love Him. So to me, before I was a Christian, these were a burden, dude. It's like Christian in, Pilgrim's Progress. The commands of the Lord are such a burden. Well, when you're truly a Christian, these things become, they're the wings that God gives you and me. See, we're not to take pride in any of these things as Christians. You know, when we start to look at what we have done,
I've been a Christian for 40 years, and, you should see our family's history. Here's my Bible, and it's signed by 200 years of Christians in our family. This is so great, and this is our history. Well, and I've been a Christian for so long. And notice, in all those things, who are we looking at?
We're looking at ourselves.
Well, I was there when Chuck was there, and boy, man, it was alive in those days. It was awesome. I was just serving, doing this, and I was serving, doing that. When I got saved, I was in this church, and I would go, and we did this ministry on the street, and we did that ministry. Hey, you know what? That's great. Praise the Lord.
What are you doing now? What am I doing now?
Well, it's all over. I'm retired now. I'm 32 years old. It's been 15 years. I'm retired from the ministry now. Or I'm 60 or I'm 80. No.
See, because again, then we're just focusing on what we did, not what the Lord did in and through that, and let that excite you and get excited for more ministry. See, if we're not out serving the Lord somewhere, if we're not serving in the church and doing these things, it just shows that something is waning in our love for the Lord. Because we shouldn't be doing those.
Well, we now head up, the parking lot ministry at Simple Faith Calvary Chapel, and I'm kind of a big guy up there now. I have 15 guys underneath me.
And it's funny, though, how easily we can do that, isn't it? Seriously, we get a little bit of a position, and next thing I'm kind of all that in a bag of chips. Or
I haven't missed a Sunday for the last 100 Sundays. Pastor Bill's been homesick a few times, but, not me.
That's great. Praise Jesus. Don't find any pride there, though. There's no place for pride in the life of a Christian. There's none in my life, in your life. And that's what Paul's getting to. Look, man, we can't look at the legalism. We have to look at the relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, our relationship with the Lord, because he said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. Again, it will be with a different heart. His heart, because his heart is now living within us. And we have to be so careful. But notice, he goes on. Back in verse 3, he told us what true spiritual worship was. Look at verse 7. He says, but what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. By the way, I love this portion of Scripture, man. This is just awesome stuff. Paul says that the things that were gained to him, he's now counted them loss for Christ. So in other words, all the things he just listed a moment ago,
circumcised the eighth day, Hebrew of Hebrews, tribe of Benjamin,
a Pharisee, all these he's like, I count all those things for loss. All of them. All the qualifications of being self-righteous. All those things that I thought were gain. Notice, but what things I thought were gain to me, these I've counted loss for Christ. Remember, he did all these things that he was speaking of in the name of the Lord. In the name of Yahweh, Jehovah. And he did all those things, but now in light of Christ, they're all for loss. You see, it's kind of like when we even become Christians, or maybe we are brought up, like I was brought up in a very religious church. He told us when to stand up, when to sit down, when to kneel, what to pray, what to say, what to do, what to pray before your meal, what to pray after, what to pray when you're going to bed, what to say. Now, I'll be honest with you. I think there was a time in the church for that to a point, because we didn't have Gutenberg and we didn't have Bibles all over the place. There was a time to memorize some of the prayers of the scriptures. But what happens is we start to trust in those works instead of the relationship we have with Jesus Christ. And a lot of people can do those works and have no relationship with Jesus Christ. Can I have an amen? Now, we as evangelicals, we as Calvary Chapel, still have to be careful of this.
I'm an evangelical. I'm not one of those Lutherans. I'm not a Catholic. I'm not a this or a that.
It's like, so what? Who cares? We're no more pedigreed than anybody else. It's about Jesus. All those things that have been done, you know, we need to understand that once we become a Christian, we don't look back at our pedigree and say, well, this is what I did here, there. No, this is what the Lord did here. This is what the Lord did there. This is how the Lord used me. I don't know how he used Bonehead like this, but isn't this so awesome? And we see the difference. One brings pride, the other brings humility. The one brings us glory, and the other brings who glory? The Lord. Let them see your good works. And give glory to your Father. You see, a lot of these things can be dangerous to hold on to. A lot of these beliefs that we can have. As we look to ourselves, as we look to a pedigree. Well, I became a Christian when I was 8 years old. That's great. Praise Jesus. Are you walking hard with him now? Are you walking close to him now? Are you spirit-filled? Are you reading his word? Are you excited about being his child? Or is it boring? A drudgery? Something you do just to check that life insurance, right? Hey, I got to make sure that if I die today, I'm going up there, not down there. So I'll set this stuff aside. Hey, you know what? I don't worry about that anymore. I know whose I am. Do you? Yes. Do you know whose you are this evening or this morning? Are we in Christ? Are we trusting alone in his righteousness? You see, he still has works prepared for you and for me. Can I have an amen? Amen. Hey, how many of us here in our own minds have retired? Don't raise your hands. Because if we're honest, there'd be a lot of people here this morning that would raise our hands. If we're honest. We might not call it retirement. We might call, well, I'm 35, I'm busy, I'm working all the time, it's crazy. Or I'm 50 and I'm busy and it's crazy and I'm working all the time in school. Or I'm 70 and I'm crazy busy. Do you see how it just is one thing after another? And we start to trust in our works instead of the saving power of Jesus Christ leading us to that place of walking in Jesus Christ. You see, beloved, as we love him, we're going to do things in response to him. Not to earn salvation, not to earn his favor. Oh, you know, I always love to, you know, think of ourselves as just still little kids. You know, Talia and I were watching one of those little funny videos you see on YouTube or Facebook, and it was this little girl, and she had to be maybe a year old. You know, and it was so cute. Her dad was sitting in the living room on the couch, and he grabbed these little Chewbacca things, you know, and he started shaking them. Ch-ch-ch-ch-ch. And this little girl comes running in the room, no, 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 no. And grabs the Chewbaccas from him and puts them over his, no, no. And then goes running out of the room. And then the dad, you can tell, he's just he grabs them again, starts shaking them. And she comes running back in, you know, no, 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 dad, no, no, no. And takes him and puts him off. And it's just like, and it goes over and over till she finally, like after 4 or 5 times, she finally just grabs him and goes, and then she just took him and run out of the room with him. But Talia and I were talking, it's like, I think sometimes with our Lord, as we're looking at God, that can be, you know, that's how God is looking at us. I'm doing all these different things. Look at me, Dad. I'm doing so great. And sometimes we'll tell God, no, 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 no. And he just kind of looks at us and laughs. There's Bill again. Oh, you know, yeah, he's 54, but man, he's still acting like he's 1 year old, you know? But there's that love. And there's that joy. And it's, again, when we think of religiosity, it makes us tired. Have an amen. Dude, I served the Lord religiously for so long, and I'm just worn out. Well, there's your problem right there, beloved. You served him religiously and not relationally. We served him because we thought we had to instead of because we're so in love with him that we want to. And that's what they were bringing in, this yoke of bondage that would come in. And it would take them to that place. So you have to keep the law. You have to do this to be saved. You have to be circumcised. But Paul said, hey, man, I don't count any of that stuff for my righteousness. Nothing. Look at verse 8. He said, yet indeed I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish that I may gain Christ. Dude, this is radical. This right here, highlight this. If you don't have it highlighted in your Bible, highlight it, underline it, star it, read through it, memorize it. I mean, just take it to where, go home and study it. He said, notice, yet indeed I also count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ, my Lord. You know, Paul counts all things for loss. Why? For the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord. Sometimes I don't think we count that such a great treasure. Amen? Sometimes I think that we are so indoctrinated, so inoculated, if you will, with Jesus Christ that it's not special anymore. But notice, he says, for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, above everything else, above a house, above a marriage, above a car, above an education, above a savings account, above a retirement. What did Paul place above all those things? His knowledge of Christ. His knowledge of Christ. Now, I don't know about you, but it's so easy to get that what, right? Upside down. We chase after all these other things. Now, there's a lot of single people in here. Some of you are at that age where you're praying maybe for a mate. Some of you are getting towards that age. And, you know, and start to, well, if I can just have a husband, I'll be complete. If I can just have a wife, I will be complete. That's a bunch of baloney. If you are not complete in Christ, a husband, a wife will not complete you. If you're in a marriage right now and you're not happy, it is because part of the reason I can guarantee is because you're looking to your wife, you're looking to your husband to complete you. They are not there for that purpose. We are only to be completed in Christ, in the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, our Lord. Hey, some of us need to, or have bad marriages, need to take a step back. Hey, what am I looking at my wife for? What am I looking at my husband for? What am I looking at my job for? My bank account? My retirement? My leisure time? There is no such thing anymore for the Christian. I'm not saying you can't retire from a job, but now it's like, okay, now you're really free to go serve the Lord. What are you going to do? What are you going to do, partner? The excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord. Hey, you know, we live in difficult times. We live in times where colleges and universities have simply become indoctrination centers. They really have. And even a lot of the ones that claim to be Christian are not teaching the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus our Lord. We have to be careful, beloved. If you're a student, be careful. If you're a mom and a dad, be careful where we're sending our kids. Be careful, be wise. You know, there's a fella who said something so profound. He is no fool who gives up that which he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. And he said this not too long before he went to minister to the, or I always mess this word up, but Harani people in Ecuador. It was Jim Elliott and four other guys as they finally landed, got off a plane, and were speared to death by those they went to save. We're never a fool to give up those things that we cannot keep. Do you understand, beloved? We cannot keep the things that we seek so hard to gain in this world. We're not bringing our house, no matter how cool it is. You're not bringing it with you. You're not bringing your car. You're not bringing your motorcycle. You're not bringing your closet full of clothes or shoes. You're not bringing your computers with your games. You're not bringing cell phones either. No cell phones in heaven. Praise Jesus. I like cell phones, don't get me wrong. But notice Paul says all these things he's counted as loss. Notice that's a purposeful action. It wasn't just something that overflowed, you know. Ooh, did that, I'm a Christian, woo, it's all gonna. No, because we still have our flesh. And it's warring against each other. So Paul had to count all these things. Notice what our translations say as rubbish. If you have an old King James, what does it say?
Dung.
Okay, I'm gonna, if you've come in here any time soon or for a while, we've talked about this a little bit. Sometimes I don't like our modern translations. I think we need a translation though that we can understand. But even, you know, when the old King James was written, you know, back in, you know, 1611, and then it's been revised through the years. But dung meant what? Dung. It meant poop. In the Greek here, it's a kind of an interesting word, skabala. And it literally means poop or excrement. But you see, sometimes I think in our Bible versions, they want to clean it up a little. We can't say poop in the Bible. But you see what happens when we just even say, you know, that it's, you know, rubbish. I don't know about you, but you can find, you know, sometimes there's a little rubbish here or there. It's, you know, not really, but when there's poop, okay? What do you do with poop? You get it out. I can walk by a little piece of rubbish in the house or outside the yard, just a little piece. It can drive us nuts. But anyway, especially my wife can drive her nuts. And that's a blessing, she is. But when there's poop, dude, what do you do? Oh, buddy, you know, our little dog, what do you do? You get it out. Why? Because it stinks. You don't even have to see it. Ooh, there's something in here. There's something here, and we start going for it, right? But remember again the context of which Paul is speaking. He is calling his own good works, his pride, everything that he owned, everything, his own heart's treasures, those things that he took great pride in and held close, they are nothing but dung, poop. Yeah, it's funny, I know. But I think it's something that that God's word says here. You know,
Pastor Bill said poop from the sermon today from the pulpit.
God's word is very clear. You see, all the things that we hold on to, what's something you wouldn't want to hold on to that you just treasure above everything? We need to count them as rubbish, as poop. Our jobs, going to school, you know, our homes, our things. Now, again, that doesn't mean we don't do these things, going to work, but we don't treasure them. You see the difference? Sometimes we're going to school for a purpose. We're going to go this. The Lord's calling me to be this. By the way, is God calling you there? A lot of us just...
Well, this is what we do. We live in America. You do this, you do that.
No, what is God calling you to do? What is God calling you to be? And after prayer and after seeking the Lord through his word and through prayer, and he shows us, then we need to do those things. But again, we do it with the reason thinking, you know what, this is poop. Because a lot of this in the school systems is what? Poop. A lot of what we hold on to, man, I got to have this house, it's a killer house, it has to be bigger and nicer, and I need property, and I need, it's all poop. Well, I got to make sure I have, you know, this great retirement. Yeah, what happens when it all crashes in the stock market? And I'm sure a lot of you lost money back in the, you know, mid-2000s, 2006, 7, 8. You know, it's interesting, in Isaiah chapter 64, we see a similar use of a pretty gross word. In Isaiah 64, 6, I'll just read it to you. It says, but we are all as an unclean thing, and our own righteousness are as filthy rags. And all we do fades as a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind have taken us away. You know, it's interesting, we all know that, right? Our righteousness is like filthy rags. You know what that word there, filthy rags, is? Do we know what that word is? Yeah, it's a menstrual rag. It's like, you know, all of our righteousness are like, you know, a used tampon. But we don't like to hear this stuff in the church today. But we need to hear this because this is basically what Paul's saying. Look, it's excrement, it's poop. All the righteous things I did, all the things that I held on into this world, all those things that I was taking pride in, they're nothing to the Lord. Are we resting in those older things? Are we resting in those things? Or are we resting in the finished work of Jesus Christ and what he did upon the cross? You see, even today, so easy to get caught up in all these different things. Hey, we need to be those who are walking in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you have an amen? Hey, we need to be those who look at all those things, even as we're doing works. It's been changed. And if it hasn't been changed for you, if you hear these things and, oh, Pastor Bill said we need to do this again, or the Bible tells me not to do that. What a bummer. I just love doing that. Well, first of all, we need to put to death our flesh. We need to crucify it, deny it every day, take it off, pick up our cross and follow after Christ. But here's the difference. When we're walking in Christ, those things, they're no longer a burden. They become just a beautiful thing, an act of love. Basically, Paul is telling us here, he's showing us how he refocused his life. Are you so caught up today with credit card bills that are, you know, up to here, and so caught up in chasing after the things of the world? Even as a Christian, have you gone to that place? Paul's teaching us, each one of us this morning, how to refocus. Look at those things in the proper context of what they are. They're there to help us, a means to an end. And that end is always to bring God glory. And if that's not their ends in our life, then we need to refocus as Christians. See, look at verse 9. He says, he's going to continue, but we're going to close here. He says, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith. This is where our righteousness is to come. Now, some of us have gone the other way over the years. Oh, I'm such a jerk. I'm such a buzzard. I'm such a sinner. I believe that God can save me, but he can never use me. Again, a lie straight from the pit of hell. Because our righteousness doesn't come from ourselves. It comes from the Lord Jesus Christ. But that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God. You see, beloved, the beautiful thing, when we repent of our sins, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and are born again of the Holy Spirit of God, something radical happens. The Holy Spirit, he comes and he indwells us. Amen? He comes, he indwells us, but then we're also covered in the blood of Jesus Christ. When the Father looks at us now, guess who he sees? He sees Jesus Christ, his Son. Perfect. Spotless. He doesn't see us in that. He's adopted us as his sons and daughters. Our righteousness now comes from God by faith. Receive this truth, beloved, today. Stand in it. Rest in it. I like what John Wycliffe said. He said, trust wholly in Christ. Rely altogether on his sufferings. Beware of seeking to be justified by any other way than by his righteousness. Faith in our Lord Jesus Christ is sufficient for salvation. There must be atonement made for sin according to the righteousness of God, and that is in Christ alone. Can I have an amen? Amen. He is no fool who gives up that which he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. What are we holding on to this morning? May we let it all go. Whether it's pride in our past accomplishments, even as Christians, whether it's things of this world, and let's let it all go. Count them as dung for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your presence in our lives that enables us to understand and to live in accordance with your word, Lord. Father, we thank you that you loved the world so much that you gave your only begotten Son, Lord. We thank you for your grace, for your love, for your mercy. And we thank you for your holiness, Lord, that you don't leave us where we are, but you clean us up, Lord, day by day, conforming us into the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, Lord. Father, we lift up those in this fellowship who continue to be hurting, Lord. Lord, we continue just to pray for Mitzi as she's lost her husband this past couple days ago, Lord Jesus. Your strength and your peace surpasses all understanding. Be with her and her family. And Lord, we again lift up those who are ill within this fellowship as well. And Father, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem this day together. We pray for those in Israel to see the light of the glory of your cross, Lord Jesus. And we pray, Lord, even as our president-elect is going to be set in office this week, Lord Jesus, that your hand would be upon him and all those that are going to be leading our country, Lord, whether they like it or not. Lord, we rest and we find strength that you are on the throne. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.